Hello viewers, welcome to my channel Pharmacypedia. This is Dr. Shikha Chauhan and in this session we are going to discuss about the different methods of analysis of complexation. So the topic has been taken from the unit 4 complexation and protein binding from physical pharmaceutics 1. If you are visiting my channel for the first time, please do like, share and subscribe to my channel Pharmacypedia for getting further updates. So in my previous video, we discussed about the complexation, what is complexation, and what are the different classification of complexation. So a complex is formed when a substrate binds to the ligand, then we get a complex. Now, when we need to identify, when we need to analyze the complex is formed or not, this can be done because each individual substrate has a different property. Each individual ligand has a different property. But when substrate and ligand forms a complex, the complex altogether has a different property. So the properties of complex are not similar to the substrate. It is not similar to the ligand, but it altogether has a different properties. So when a substrate is being formed, we can analyze the formation of the complex in a way that it has different properties, different physical properties, different chemical properties. For example, complexation leads to the change of the physical as well as the chemical properties. It leads to the change in the solubilities. It leads to the changes in the stabilities, it leads to the change in the absorption, also it leads to the change in the pharmacokinetic properties and the dynamic properties as well. So when we want to analyze whether after a reaction of the substrate or the ligand a complex is formed or not, we can simply detect the formation of the complex. Either a complex would be formed or there would be no complexation. There is not a mediocre thing. The reason being, when a complex is formed, it is formed completely and it can be analyzed by the altered physical properties, altered chemical properties. So technically speaking, when we talk about the method of analyzing whether there is a formation of complex or not, it can be done either by two ways. The first is the stoichiometric ratio. So stoichiometric ratio basically determines the donor acceptor ratio. In our case, our substrate is the acceptor and our ligand is the donor. So this donor acceptor ratios, the amount of this donor acceptor ratios and its properties can help us determine the formation of the complex. Second is the stability constant. So by measuring the stability constant, by the study of the rate of the complex degradation, we can analyze and determine the presence of the complex. So our motto is not to determine the quantity of the complex formed. We simply want to know by the various techniques whether the complex is formed. So when substrate comes into contact with the ligand, if there is any formation of the complex, then there would be change in the physical or chemical properties. So we can determine through either stoichiometric ratios or by the stability constants. So basically, there are four methods which are used for the determination of the complex formation. The first is known as the method of continuous variation. Second is the distribution method. Third is the solubility method. And fourth is the pH titration method. Before understanding each and individual method, let us first try to understand the principle behind each of the methods. So like for the method of the continuous variation, as I have told, substrate has a different properties, ligand has a different properties, and when they combine to form the complex, it has a different properties. So there is a continuous variation in the physicochemical properties which we can measure experimentally. So if experimentally it is found that there is a altered properties or variation, for example, in the dielectric constant or in the spectroscopic values or in the absorbance or transmittance, we can simply say that the complex is formed, therefore there is a change in the properties. Second is the distribution method, also based on the partitioning of method. So when a drug when a complex is being formed, the rate of partition into the either in the water or in the oil or polar or non-polar phase changes. So due to this difference in the distribution, we can determine whether a complex is formed or not. Third is the solubility method. Each and every drug substance has its own solubility constant. So when a complex is being formed, it has a different solubility constant. And this variation in the solubility constant can make us understand whether a complex is formed or not. Last is the pH titration method. This is one of the specific method. So if a solubility is changed, the physical chemical properties are altered when a complex is being formed. Similarly, the proton concentration also varies. So like due to the changes in the proton concentration, the pH also changes. So this variation in the pH can also be remarkable, help us in determining whether the complex has been formed or not. So our objective is to understand through either of these techniques whether the complex has been formed or not. So like general procedure, when we talk about the complexation, so we have a ligand, we have an a substrate, so we combine to form the complex. So by applying the stability constants on both the sides and by observing the change in the properties, physical chemical properties, we can understand by the variation in the stability constants whether the complex is formed or not. Let us first try to understand with the first method, which is also known as the continuous variation method. So like when a substrate reacts with the ligand and forms the complex, there would be deviation in the physical chemical properties. So as discussed earlier, we have a different substrate properties, we have different ligand properties, but once a complex has been formed, so the complex would have a different physicochemical properties. So for example, it may vary in the dielectric constant values, it may vary in the refractive index values, or it may vary in the spectrophotometric extinct coefficients. So like when we do the experimental analysis and find that the readings are different, then we can determine that the complex is formed or not formed. So it is very simple to understand. For example, we are combining A and B. So if no complexation is there, that means the physical chemical properties are additive in nature. But when a complexation is formed, the physical chemical properties values is very different. It may be very high, it may be very low. So it is because it is having altogether a different property. So in this case, when we apply the method of continuous variation, due to the complexation, physicochemical properties results may either be minimum or maximum. So at the minimum point or the maximum point, the concentration of the individual species may vary. So by that, we can calculate the stoichiometric ratio of the species. For example, here we are taking the example of the change in the dielectric constant. So when there is no complex formation, you can see we have a straight line. But once there is a formation of the complex, you can see the dielectric constant is varying for the complex because of the formation of the complex. Next, we move on to the spectroscopic estimations. It is being observed that the rate of transmittance changes and the coefficient is different when a complex is being formed. So by applying the equation, we can understand this variation in the transmittance or the absorption is due to the formation of the complex. Next method is the distribution method, also known as the partition coefficient method. It is a very simple method whereby we can estimate whether there is a formation of the complex or not. So the classic example is used to is the complexation of the iodine. So what we take a flask and we fill half of with the water and we fill other half with the polar solvent. So like when we are filling, other of the iodine will distribute in the water as well as in the oil. So the concentration, the partition coefficient, once it is being shaken for a specified period of the time, the partition coefficient, that is the amount of the iodine which penetrates into the water, the amount of the iodine which penetrates into the oil will be determined by the constant K. So once we have determined this value, the other experiment can be that we are replacing it with the potassium iodide. So what will happen? Iodine plus carbon tetrachloride plus water, when it is shaken and we have determined the constant by using the titration methods. But once we have added potassium iodide instead of the water, so in the second paragraph you can see we have added potassium iodide in replacement for the water, then we observe that there is a formation of the complex. potassium iodide is forming the complex with the iodine. Now, due to the formation of the complex, the partition coefficient K value varies. So, by conducting this experiment simply, we can observe that if there is the formation of the complex, then the value of the K would be different. So, this is the from these simple experiments, one can know whether there is the complex formation or not. Because iodine does not form the complex with the water, it simply forms the complex with the potassium iodide, which we can determine using titer metrically using 0.1 normal sodium thiosulfite and by using the starch base as an indicator. Third is the solubility method. So, like we have seen that there is the change in the properties, for example, in the pH values, for example, in the partition coefficient distribution, amount of the drug distribution. On the similar lines, one can expect that there is a solubility changes as well. So, for every drug substance, there is a constant for the solubility. So, once a complex is being formed, the solubility constant varies, represented by K here. The classic example used is for the caffeine. Caffeine is generally used as a complexing agent, which is taken in different concentrations. So, once we add para-aminobenzoic acid with the caffeine, a complex is being formed. So, when we try to determine the solubility constant, once this complex has been made, it is different. So, like carrying out the experiment and analyzing the drug concentration, we can determine whether the constant is whether the complexation has taken place or not, because once a para-aminobenzoic acid caffeine complex is formed, the solubility constant will be different from individually para-aminobenzoic acid and the caffeine, because each of them has a different solubility constant. But a complex is being formed, the complex has altogether a different solubility constant. So the formation of the complex can be determined by determining the solubility constant, also known as the dissociation constant. So here you can see, once the caffeine has formed the complex with the para-aminobenzoic acid, we can say that the solubility constant value has changed, which can be determined also by putting up the values, and it is coming somewhere around 195.6 here. So next method which is used for the determination of the complex formation is the pH titration method. My dear students, it is one of the most reliable method which is used to understand the formation of complex. Complexation is usually affected by the change in the pH. So once we can study it by taking the example of the glycine. So when we take glycine, it has a pH around above 6 to 8. But once the glycine forms the complex with the copper, then the complex is having lower pH. So the variation in the pH, by determining the variation in the pH, we can confirm whether the complex has been formed or not. If we found the pH around 2 to 4, it simply indicates the formation of the complex. So in the graph also you can see that once we mix the glycine with the copper and the complex is being formed, this complex formation can be determined by simply experimentally recording the values of the pH. So lower pH will represent the formation of the complex. So the pH method is very specific method, and it is suitable if the complexation produces change in the pH. So it can be determined. So it can be carried out very simply. If you take the glycine solution, titrate it with the sodium hydroxide and record the pH. Once glycine is taken along with the cuprous complex, and this complex is then titrated with the sodium hydroxide and pH is recorded. So the lowering down of the pH would indicate the formation of the complex. So these are the four main techniques which are used to determine and whether the complex is being formed when a substrate is allowed to react with the ligand. Because substrate has a different properties, ligand has a different properties, and once we mix the substrate with the ligand, the variation in the physical chemical properties due to the formation of the complex will help us determine the formation of complex or not. The objective here is not to determine the quantity of the, because we are just simply analyzing whether the complex is formed or not. Here I am trying to explain the complexation and the various drug actions. So like various complexes, for example, cisplatin when combined with the carboplatin and platinum 2 complex is highly useful in the cancer treatment. Similarly, the povidone iodine complex is water soluble and can be easily removed from binding the sites. then carboxymethyl cellulose and amphetamine complex is poorly absorbed complex. So like each and every complex has a totally different altered properties as compared to the substrate. Thank you so much for watching my video. If you have any doubt or query, please reply in the comment box. Thank you so much once again for liking the videos and for watching the videos. Please do like, share and subscribe to my channel Pharmacypedia for getting further updates.